Hello, and welcome to the CDRH Industry Basics Workshop. I'm Elias Malis, Director of the Division of Industry and Consumer Education at CDRH, and I'll be your moderator for today's program. Thank you for joining us. The CDRH Industry Basics Workshop brings you the fundamentals on some key areas of FDA's medical device regulations. It's important for you to understand these basic principles in order to successfully navigate the FDA regulatory landscape. This objective addresses the core vision of the Division of Industry and Consumer Education to provide you with accurate, timely, and useful educational information about medical devices. In addition to the workshop you're viewing today, we've developed a wealth of other educational resources designed specifically for you. Please take advantage of them. One of these resources is CDRH Learn. CDRH Learn is a multimedia catalog of online educational modules, presentations, and audio webinars that cover a wide range of medical device regulatory topics. If you have a question about a specific medical device regulation or policy, this is a great place to check out. Another industry education resource we've designed for you is Device Advice. Device Advice provides comprehensive regulatory assistance about medical devices with hundreds of web pages of information at your fingertips. The format for today's program will be as follows. We'll start with a presentation by a speaker from CDRH. At the end of the presentation, the speaker will be joined by a panel of experts from CDRH, and we'll have approximately 20 minutes for an interactive question and answer session with you. We'll also be able to take your calls during this time. After the session has ended, we'll continue with the next topic. We'll cover two topics during today's program, which focus on the quality system regulation. For these two topics, we'll take a closer look at one of the seven subsystems of the quality system regulation, specifically production and process controls. We'll follow a schedule so you can join in for the topics that are of interest to you. We'll begin with our first topic, purchasing controls. At 2 p.m., we'll transition to our second topic of the day, process validation. Thank you again for joining us today, and now let's get started.
Hello, my name is Joseph Tartle, and I am the Post-Market and Consumer Branch Chief in the Division of Industry and Consumer Education. In this presentation, we will review the topic of purchasing controls. The medical device industry has a direct impact on patients and their health, and you as manufacturers have the final responsibility for the medical devices that you distribute. This includes responsibility over the materials, components, and services used. I understand and have seen firsthand the impact that suppliers can have on a product and the importance of purchasing controls. I can provide examples from over the last 10 years where failed components and contaminated materials have directly related to device failures and adverse events, including deaths. In the world today that is global and with connected economies, accountability is important, and you are responsible for establishing and maintaining that accountability as it relates to everything received for your finished device. This is the expectation of FDA and the expectation of your customers. Let's review the learning objectives for this presentation. By the time I am finished, I want you to know the following. First, understand the intent and background as it relates to purchasing controls. Why does it matter? Why is it important to FDA? And what is unique about medical devices? Know the definitions of product, component, and service, as you want to use the correct terms and know their meaning to properly communicate within your organization and with suppliers. Next, understand the purchasing control requirements in the regulation, which is what you have to do legally, as well as the voluntary guidance and best practices for qualifying suppliers. These are good ideas on how to meet the requirements. And finally, I hope you'll be able to recognize the links between purchasing and other quality system requirements, such as design controls and acceptance activities, and know how they interact with one another. This is important as the most effective quality systems are interconnected. During this presentation, I'll refer to several key documents that address purchasing controls. 21 Code of Federal Regulations, or CFR, Section 820 refers to the quality system regulation. 21 CFR 820.50 codified the regulations for purchase controls. And finally, we have the preamble to the 1996 quality system regulation. Public comments and the FDA responses to those comments are found in the preamble of the 96 Quality System Regulation, and they provide further insight into the agency's thinking with respect to purchasing controls. As appropriate, I'll cross-reference the applicable comment found in the preamble with the particular topic. These are listed at the bottom of the slide and highlighted in blue. Overall, we do not think of quality as just test and inspect. The evolution of quality in our industry has moved from a test and inspect mentality to control over design and manufacturing to also qualifying and selecting suppliers in the medical device supply chain that are both capable and can meet your needs. Preamble comment number 106 makes the intent of purchasing controls clear and that we need to look at suppliers and select them on their capabilities to provide quality product and services, and that quality cannot be inspected or tested into products or services. Why does purchasing controls matter? Technologies are becoming more complex and firms are becoming more dependent on each other in the manufacture of these complex medical devices. As a result, the quality of finished medical devices depends on a number of factors, many of which you do not directly control within your facility as a finished device manufacturer, even though you have the final responsibility for your product. With increased globalization, it becomes apparent that quality is not bound by borders. The quality of raw materials, components, and services will directly affect your finished device. For example, back in 2008, a contaminated raw material was used in a medical device and resulted in dozens of related adverse events, including 11 deaths. Other supplier-related issues have also been the cause of both medical device recalls and customer dissatisfaction. FDA is concerned about purchasing controls because FDA rarely looks at suppliers. FDA inspections often only extend to the finished device manufacturers, and FDA does not perform routine inspection of component manufacturers. Also, there is a potential for the problems due to the risk of failure in the supply chain, and that supply chain has grown to include contract manufacturing of the finished device itself and virtual companies. Therefore, purchasing controls are necessary to assure that only acceptable raw materials, components, and services are used. The expectation, not just from a compliance perspective, the bare minimum, but also from a quality perspective, is that you have control of the components, raw materials, and services you use, and that you're confident that suppliers can continually provide quality product and services. There are unique aspects to medical devices. First, there is a wide range in the types of received products and services, which could be raw materials, components, software, contract manufacturers, and consultants, to name a few. There is a wide range of complexity with received products, including its role in the overall medical device total product lifecycle. As examples, you may have a consultant who prepares a pre-market submission or a service contractor who performs maintenance on a medical device in distribution. Also, who supplies your product can be important, such as off-the-shelf software from a large corporation or sole source material from a single researcher at a university. All of it will come under your purchasing controls. We have a wide range of risks associated with received products and services. Materials and components that are being used in medical devices may have never been originally intended for medical device usage. At DICE, we receive calls and questions about FDA-approved food-grade materials and their use in medical devices. We then explain that medical devices and the materials used are dependent upon their intended use. If a material is approved as a food-grade material or even in a medical device that contacts the skin, it does not mean it will then be okay for use in an implant. Depending on use, the same exact material may have increased risk and may need to be controlled differently. For example, stainless steel may be graded and controlled differently dependent on the specific intended use of the device in which it's used. Purchasing controls are applicable when you do not have direct control over the product, such as received materials and components, or services you've received that can potentially impact the quality of the medical device. A good rule of thumb is to determine if these are covered under your own quality system and subsequent internal quality audits. If they are not, purchasing controls apply. Over the next few slides, we'll review a few key terms and definitions. It is important to know and use the correct terms so that when communicating, everyone is on the same page. Most regulations have their definitions under the .3 section of that regulation. Product is defined as components, manufacturing materials, in-process devices, finished devices, and return devices. Basically, everything except service. This is found in 21 CFR 820.3R. Components are any raw material, substance, piece, part, software, firmware, labeling, or assembly, which is intended to be included as part of the finished, packaged, and labeled device. Note, this is different than a finished device, which is any device or accessory to any device that is suitable for use or capable of functioning, whether or not it is packaged, labeled, or sterilized. This definition is found in 21 CFR 820.3C. In preamble comment number 102, service is defined as parts of the manufacturing or quality system that are contracted to others. For example, plating of metals, testing, and sterilizing. Any contractual work that is being done for you that can affect the quality of your medical device or quality system. FDA believes that suppliers of these services must be assessed and evaluated, just like a supplier of a product. The degree of control necessary is related to the product or service purchased. Please note, consultants provide a service. As mentioned earlier, purchasing controls are codified in the regulation under 21 CFR 820.50. These are shall statements or requirements that you must do in order to comply with the regulations. In addition, pay attention to the preamble comments that relate to purchasing controls, some of which are referenced in this presentation. Last, there is the Global Harmonization Task Force 2008 Supplier Control Guidance that provides the most up-to-date guidance on medical device supplier controls. As a reminder, all guidances, such as this one, are voluntary and not mandatory. This guidance may be found at the International Medical Device Regulators Forum webpage in the GHTF archives under Study Group 3. Please feel free to click on each hyperlink after the presentation. I will now start with the regulatory requirements for purchasing controls. Establish, meaning define, document, implement, do, and maintain procedures to ensure that all purchased or otherwise received product and services conform to specified requirements. This is a requirement, and it does not matter if you purchased it or it was given to you. For example, if materials were provided to you as part of a grant or sister facility, purchasing controls still apply. See preamble comment number 100. Again, all entities not covered by your own quality system and internal quality audits should be treated as suppliers. The following comes from a good flow chart on page 10 in the voluntary GHTF guidance document. It provides a great overview of what to consider when setting up your procedures. There are 6 steps to supplier controls. 1, planning. 2, selection of potential suppliers. 3, evaluation and acceptance of suppliers. 4, finalization of responsibilities and controls. 5, delivery, measurement, and monitoring. And 6, communication, including the corrective and preventive action process. However, please note these steps are not strictly sequential, as some activities may occur in parallel and overlap one another. The next regulatory requirement is to establish and maintain requirements, including quality requirements that suppliers, contractors, and consultants must meet. These are objective, measurable requirements that are put into place to determine how suppliers will be evaluated. You then evaluate and select potential suppliers, contractors, and consultants on the basis of their ability to meet specified requirements, including quality requirements. The evaluation shall be documented. From a compliance perspective, if it is not documented, it did not happen. I want to also caution you to not exclusively rely on third-party certification for initial evaluation of a supplier, and with the use of any certification, ask, what it means to you and your device. You will now need to define the type and extent of control to be exercised based on the evaluation results. You determine what is required, you are the customers, and depending upon this, you may be able to leverage more control if needed. Be mindful of higher risk products and services as they relate to your device and of sub-tier suppliers, meaning suppliers of your supplier. Establish and maintain records of acceptable suppliers, contractors, and consultants. I have seen this accomplished through approved vendor list. As for whatever methods you use, make sure it is followed and you have documented procedures and records of it. Regarding control over suppliers, you may need more in-house controls during receiving, or you may leverage the supplier to adopt certain measures. For some suppliers, I have seen examples of quality system and process validation knowledge being transferred to the supplier as part of an agreement to better control the products being supplied, as both parties wanted a win-win scenario. I suggest that you make sure to document all expectations in your supplier agreements and have them agreed upon by both parties. Now you must make sure that purchasing control data are established and maintained, and the data clearly describes or references the specified requirements. These have to be approved per your document controls. Purchasing documents shall include, where possible, an agreement to be notified of changes. I recommend that notification for change controls be done before those changes are implemented. Then make sure the agreement is being followed. Also define what those changes are. They may be to their process or even changes to their suppliers. Last, be aware of informal communication channels and of over-reliance on notification, especially for suppliers over which you have limited control. The capability of the product or service suppliers should be reviewed at intervals consistent with the significance of the product or service provided, and the review should demonstrate conformance to specified requirements. Action thresholds should be objective and consistently applied. Ongoing communication. What happens when things go wrong? In every relationship, both parties have a proportion of responsibility to the relationship, whether it is 50-50 or 99-1%. As you become aware of information, you will process it through your quality system, but also report it back to your supplier depending upon its importance. Discuss how they handle complaints and their willingness to provide information. Examples of things I have seen used in industry are vendor corrective action reports and supplier corrective action reports. Purchasing controls are driven by and linked to other quality systems, such as design controls, 21 CFR 820.30, and acceptance activities, 21 CFR 820.80. If you design in quality the first time, you design the right device. Your design specifications will drive your purchasing controls, and you want to spend the time up front to identify the right suppliers. For acceptance activities, I recommend using RISC to strike a balance for controlling supplied product and services through a combination of purchasing controls and acceptance activities. If, for example, you have a sole source supplier and cannot perform active supplier evaluations, then you'll need more emphasis on acceptance activities. The quality of a product or service is established during the design of that product or service and achieved through proper control of the manufacturer of that product or the performance of that service. That quality includes the product and services that you received and are subsequently used in your finished device. During design, you have to select suppliers that provide quality product and service. Design specifications are determined in design controls, such as design inputs, and then verified as design outputs. These will drive your purchasing decisions. For example, a supplier who provides an essential design output will likely have greater controls. In industry, I have seen suppliers rated in tiers depending upon the product risk or service provided. This even included contractors who were performing a critical service. Be cautious of one-size-fits-all approaches to balancing supplier controls and assessment activities. You determine it. Establish and maintain procedures for acceptance activities of incoming product. Inspections, tests, and other verification tools are an important part of ensuring that raw materials, components, and other received product conform to approved specifications. Document all acceptance and rejection activities. Use a combination of purchasing controls and acceptance activities to ensure all received product meet your specified requirements. The extent of incoming acceptance activities can be based, in part, on the degree to which the supplier has demonstrated a capability to provide quality products or services. For example, doc to stock. The practice of using document review to accept supplied product is acceptable if you can show effective purchasing controls and a history of providing quality products or services. In summary, I ask that you take on the following calls to action. First, know that purchasing controls pertain to all received products and services. Second, select your suppliers based on their capabilities and your manufacturing requirements. Third, establish adequate supplier controls. Fourth, documentation is important. Establish and maintain records regarding purchasing, purchasing data, and reviews. And finally, understand that following purchasing controls are good for your business and the public health in general. This presentation and other helpful videos and educational resources can be found at CDRH Learn. For text-based information on pre-market and post-market topics, including how to bring a medical device to market, please visit Device Advice. For additional information on these or any other medical device regulatory topics, we encourage you to contact the Division of Industry and Consumer Education with your questions. Thanks for watching.
Thank you for viewing the presentation on purchasing controls. I hope you found the information helpful, and now we're going to try to answer your questions. You can submit questions by clicking the Ask a Question icon, which looks like a thought bubble on the top left corner of your screen. You can also call us at 1-800-527-1401 if you'd like to ask your question live. Our next session, which is on process validation, we'll begin promptly at 2 o'clock, so we'll do our best to answer as many questions as we can before then. Here to help answer your questions is Joseph Tartle, who just gave the presentation on purchasing controls. We're also joined by Eric Horowitz, Quality Systems Working Group Lead from CDRH's Office of Compliance, and Tanya Wilbon, Quality Systems Specialist in CDRH's Office of In Vitro Diagnostics and Radiological Health. Now let's get to some questions. We have our first question that's come in already. Thank you all. And we'll start off with Tanya for this first question. Do purchasing controls apply to corporate suppliers?
Yes, purchasing controls do apply to corporate suppliers, specifically if they are not part of that quality management system and they are not undergoing that facility's internal audit. So yes, they would apply to those corporate suppliers.
Okay, thank you, Tanya. All right, let's get to our next question. Do manufacturers need process validation for outsourced processes? For example, PCBA or injection molding for product enclosure. These processes are done by our approved supplier, and we, the manufacturer, just do the assembling. So Eric, how about taking this question?
So the answer to this question is really dependent on the process itself. What is required for you to establish with your supplier really is very similar to what would be required if you were doing the process in-house. Really, you do need to establish that your supplier or you has validated that process. However, if, on the other hand, it's a process that can be fully verified, it's possible that instead you could use acceptance activities as your method for doing things. The important thing is that you've done what's necessary in order to have confidence in that product.
Okay, thank you. All right, we'll get to our next question. Who is responsible for a device that is manufactured by a contract manufacturer? So maybe Joe, take this one.
So you have a contract manufacturer who is going to have certain responsibilities per the purchasing control agreement that you've put into place. However, you as the finished device manufacturer, the owner of the device, the person who owns the 510K, a pre-market submission, or PMA, had the final responsibility for that finished device. No matter what you do with regard to your purchasing controls, you cannot outsource your responsibility. At the end of the day, you always have that final responsibility, including that responsibility over their contract manufacturers.
Okay, all right, thank you. All right, we'll get to our next question. This is about raw materials. If a raw material is purchased from a large manufacturer as an off-the-shelf item, do we still need vendor specifications in place? So, Tanya?
Sure. Yes, you certainly need vendor specifications in place because you have to ensure that those raw materials that you are receiving in from whomever your supplier is do meet the specifications that you have already identified to be incorporated for your finished device. So, yes, you would need those specifications in place for the raw materials.
Okay.
Correct.
Yes.
And I would like to add one other thing. With regards to purchase controls, it's also the addition of the capability of that supplier to provide those raw materials. So from a pragmatic standpoint, you want to pick suppliers that you know are going to be able to continue to provide you that raw material over and over and over again. So I would say, not only do you need the vendor specifications, you also need to evaluate and ensure that that supplier of that raw material meet your purchasing controls.
And the other thing I would add to that is going along what was already discussed about who has responsibility if you have someone contract manufacturing things. Even if there is a generalized product that you're receiving, it's still your responsibility to have established what your requirements are of that product. And you can't rely on the person who is supplying that product to really establish what your requirements are.
Okay,
correct. And that's a very good point because with medical devices, intended use can change things. You can have the same type of material used in multiple type of devices, and those specifications may change because the intended use of the devices change.
And you talked about that in your presentation, yep. I think. All right, let's get to our next question. Thank you, panelists. Do distributors of finished good medical devices require purchasing controls? So, distributors. Tanya.
With regards to purchasing controls, those are the responsibilities of finished device manufacturers. So if the distributor is not a finished device manufacturer, which they are not in most cases, then they are not required by the quality system regulation to have those purchasing controls in place. They may have to meet and be in discussions with regards to what's included, but it's only the finished device manufacturer that is required per the quality system regulation.
Okay, thank you. Let's get to our next question. They're coming in very quickly. Please send in your questions. Can a component or service be brought under the QMS of the medical device manufacturer, that is 100% incoming QC, as an alternative to supplier control? So it's a big question.
So it's not necessarily that that would be a complete alternative to supplier controls. You need to have a balance, as Joe discussed in the presentation, between your acceptance activities and supplier controls. Just because you're doing 100% verification doesn't necessarily mean that you've got everything that you need. The basic concept is that you still need to approve your supplier. You still need to have confidence in that supplier, even if you're doing 100% receiving acceptance.
And I would also add, with regards of replacing purchasing controls are required, again, according to the quality system regulations, if you are receiving product or services into your facility. However general they may be, you still have to have them in place, which doesn't mean you may need additional acceptance activities in place to sort of ensure, have that level of insurance that the product or services that you are receiving meet your specifications. So you may have to do some additional testing if you're not doing more specific or if you do not have more specific and detailed purchasing controls in place. But you have to have some type of purchasing controls when you are receiving product or services into your facility.
Okay, thank you. Mm-hmm. So our next question is a second question about the raw materials that we asked earlier. This one asked asks, what if the raw materials come with a certificate of analysis documents? Can that be used in place of vendor specifications?
So, and I believe I talked a little bit about this in the presentation, in that whatever certificates that you're using, whether it's certificates of conformance, certificate of analysis, first you need to understand what those certificates mean for your specifications with regards to that raw material. Just like the previous questions, you're still going to do some sort of purchasing and supplier controls so that you have an understanding of the capacity and capabilities of that supplier. So while they're used a lot and we see certificates of analysis, they're basically, I would not over rely on them too much. I would say that you're still required per the regulation to do purchasing controls and to qualify that supplier to some degree. And even though you have that certificate of analysis, you're also going to still do some sort of receiving acceptance, even though it may be more limited because you're now relying off of that certificate of analysis itself. Like I said, one thing I would make sure of is truly understand that certificate of analysis and the data that's there and make sure that it's truthful to your specification, not just a vendor certificate of analysis that just tells you something in particular, because you need to understand what it means to your product and your device and the impact that it has.
Okay.
And the other thing that I would add to that is that it's important to understand how that analysis is carried out, to really understand the test methods that your vendor is using, because without really understanding, as Joe said, what that certificate of analysis means, you don't have any confidence in what you're getting out of it.
Excellent. Thank you, panelists. And I have one more follow-up question about raw materials. It sounds like that's an important theme for our audience. Are medical device raw material suppliers inspected by the FDA? And if not, what evidence is required to demonstrate supplier compliance if the company is not ISO 13485 certified? So, Tanya?
Okay, sure. So I will need help with reiterating. Appears to be multiple parts to that question. So I will begin with regards to the question about whether or not raw materials will actually get inspected, or the manufacturer of a raw material materials. Typically, they are not, but however, we do have the authority to inspect those component manufacturers. Typically, they are not. However, sometimes with regards to those Class 3 medical devices with certain components or raw materials, they may be inspected. So typically, they're not, but they're not off the books for being inspected.
Okay. So the second part to the question, I'll just repeat it. So if they're not, and you're saying largely they're not, what evidence would be required to demonstrate supplier compliance if the company is not ISO 13485 certified? So, Eric?
So there's a couple things going on there. One, really, FDA inspections should not be what you're relying on for your supplier controls. Simply knowing that the FDA inspected a company and that they didn't get any observations doesn't tell you that your supplier is providing the product that you need. Really, the important thing is to understand what your needs are, what your requirements are, and establish that with your vendor to be able to exert the types of controls that you need. A given certification or a given FDA inspection is not really what you should be relying on.
And I'll add with regards to what are some of the requirements you have to have in place. Remember, you have to have in place all of those applicable requirements within the quality system regulation. So whatever activities you are performing at your facility with regards to providing those raw materials would be the requirements within the quality system regulation that you would have to meet. And here again, the agency will be looking at the purchasing control you have in place with regards to the requirements you are requesting from your raw material manufacturer.
Okay, thank you.
And I actually wanted to add one other point to that, as Eric had pointed out, that you want to be in control of your suppliers. That's why purchasing controls are in place. If FDA is going and looking at your supplier and possibly even their supplier, it generally means that something probably has gone wrong. And that's where you do not want to be. You want to be in control of your suppliers, that you're not going to have those issues, because generally FDA is not going to go look at those suppliers. So one of those things is you have that final responsibility for that material, and therefore you want to make sure that you have the right material that's being made and it's rightly controlled, so that whether it's an ISO certification or even if FDA has looked at them, that's not giving you the high confidence. You have to have that high confidence built into your supplier controls yourself, because you're the one purchasing that material and you're the ones who have final responsibility of that material used in your devices.
Excellent. So thank you, panelists, for clarifying. That's a very important point. So our next question comes from the perspective of a contract manufacturer. So this stakeholder states, we are a contract manufacturer and we receive components from our customer to use in their product assembly. Are we required to exercise purchasing controls for this customer-supplied material? So that's the question before us.
I'll take a stab at it. I think I would really need some additional clarification to adequately address the question. I'm kind of unsure as to who is providing the component. They mentioned a user.
The contract manufacturer receives components from their customers to use in their product assembly.
So it's customer supplied material. I would say that it's not necessarily that they're going to have their own purchasing controls. Where I would build this in is the contractual agreement that you have as the contract manufacturer with that medical device manufacturer. So if we can step it back, I'm a medical device manufacturer. Mm-hmm. I contract out to Elias to manufacture my device. On top of it, I provide some components and subassemblies to him to complete that contract manufacturing. I would then say that should be covered in the initial contractual agreements that the manufacturer has underneath their own purchasing controls, but I do agree that it will depend on a lot of different things. It should be covered somewhere. That's probably the bottom line that I would put in.
So whoever.
Yeah, and I would add, there is a dependency on whether or not you, the contract manufacturer, are a finished device manufacturer yourselves. If you are, then you're subject to the quality system regulation, and you should have everything in place, including supplier controls. The important thing to really note about that is that, unlike with some requirements like pre-market requirements, there isn't this concept of ultimate responsibility. If you and your customer are both finished device manufacturers related to this product, you both have the responsibility. You aren't off the hook just because your customer has responsibility too.
And feel free to contact either of us for additional discussion with regards to that question. I would really, want to get that additional information to provide them with a more detailed response.
Absolutely. And as part of this program is providing educational outreach for our stakeholders. They can contact our division, DICE, for follow-up. And for any of these nuanced questions, we'll be happy to answer them.
Yes.
So we have our first caller who's come in. We have a caller from Mina. So thank you for contacting us, and we'd love to hear your question for the panel.
Yes. For onboarding of new suppliers, can the manufacturer accept the new supplier based on review of their ISO certificate and audit them every two or three years or is initial supplier audit critical?
So one of the things the preamble says is to be careful of using certifications to do initial supplier qualifications. So while you can use that ISO certification, it wouldn't be the only type of evaluation I would use with regards to onboarding or qualifying that supplier for the first time.
Now, there was another question that was kind of rolled into that, which was, do you have to do initial supplier audits?
And that's a different
which
question.
Is a slightly different question. You do not have to do initial supplier audits. If there are other mechanisms by which you can approve a supplier, the mechanisms that you should be using are those that will work for what you need from that supplier. If that mechanism is an initial audit, do an initial audit. If there's another mechanism like a document audit or some other type of supplier controls that you can use for approving that supplier, that's just as acceptable. It doesn't have to be an audit.
Correct. To clarify what Eric said, there's no requirement in the regulation that you have to perform supplier audits.
Right. However, the regulation does require that you conduct an evaluation
Correct.
Of that supplier. And keep in mind, if you're using, for example, ISO 13485 to conduct your evaluation, that may be acceptable, but keep in mind there are some differences with regards to quality system regulation requirements. So if you're evaluating this firm to demonstrate their ability to meet your specifications for the product or services that they are providing, you want to make sure that they are meeting those quality system regulation for products that you want to market here within the United States.
Thank you, caller, for your question. We appreciate that. So let's go back to our online questions. This next one is perhaps similar to the caller's question. Are there specific requirements for auditing suppliers and their process?
Right.
So
here again, to piggyback off of both what Eric and Joe emphasized, there's no requirement to audit those suppliers. However, 820.50 on the quality system regulation requires an evaluation of those suppliers, of their ability and capability to provide the product and services that meet your specified requirements.
Go ahead, Eric.
Sure. One thing that I definitely would add is that you are responsible for carrying out your supplier controls as you define them.
Yep.
If you define that the way that you're going to control your supplier is through supplier audits, then you have to do supplier audits. If you define that you're going to exert that control in another way, then you don't have to do supplier audits. It's really important that when you establish your supplier controls, you follow through and do what you said you were going to do.
Joe, did you want to?
That's exactly what
okay,
I was
perfect.
Going to say.
Very good.
And I would add to it to be careful that if you say, I think the caller had mentioned, if you say, I'm going to do supplier audits every 2 years, then you've put that on yourselves, and now you have to follow it, unless you change it accordingly to your own quality system.
Okay, so our next online question is focusing on multiple suppliers. What are the best practices for establishing and maintaining purchasing controls for purchasing materials from distributors that distribute for multiple suppliers?
So, I don't know, do you...
Say receives material from different
multiple
sources
suppliers.
And then farms it out. It's a similar sort of process that it actually brings up a very important point about supplier controls, which is that you are responsible for your supplier's supplier controls. You need to ensure that your supplier is exerting adequate supplier controls on their suppliers so that you have confidence in what you're getting from your supplier.
And it appeared that they also were interested in whether or not there's a concern or a prohibition of a distributor to distribute products for multiple finished device manufacturers or multiple entities, and there's no prohibition. They can do that. They can serve as a distributor. You, as the finished device manufacturer, though, may want to ensure that you consider that. You know, are there any possibilities of mixing up our product with other product that these distributors are also distributing? So you may want to address that and make sure that you have controls in place to alleviate that if there is a concern or possibility.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Thank you so much. Sure. This next question, I think it's picking off of perhaps your presentation, Joe, so we'll ask it for you. If there is a need to expand on supplier evaluation internal procedures to further conform to the regulation, how do you take into account historical performance of a supplier?
Okay, so when you're doing your supplier controls, you have, you're required to put your procedures in place. And from that, you're going to collect purchasing data over time. And as you collect that purchasing data, whether it be supplier audits or whatever evaluation that you've put into place, you're going to start building upon a relationship with them. And as I talked about on the presentation, you're also going to build in, where possible, any type of contractual agreements with them as well. In those agreements, you can build in what the expectations are, and as you feel more comfortable with that particular supplier, then you may go from doing 100% acceptance to maybe doing a sample of acceptance activities coming in. But that's where you're really building into using the information that you've built over time to get a good picture of what that supplier has been doing. And you never want to let it completely go, because you're always going to have that monitoring that's ongoing and that ongoing communication. But once you've become comfortable with that supplier and they've shown that they can consistently supply you that same materials, then maybe your monitoring might change. So that I think that answers the question with how you would use that data.
And the other thing that I would point out that Joe actually mentioned in his slides was the incorporation of risk, which is a very important aspect of this. Really incorporating your risk management system into how you look at supplier controls so that you really are evaluating the different data sources that you have to identify where the areas of improvement are and where there are risks that need to be mitigated.
Correct, and I'd add one thing to that. If I have something that I've deemed is an essential design output and there's certain high levels of risk, that historical data over time is going to continue to build, but I still may always keep high acceptance activities in place because I've already deemed that this is really critical to my product and my processes.
Okay. So let's keep going with our next question. When purchasing manufacturing equipment or off-the-shelf software, are purchasing controls required for those vendors? So yes. Maybe take them one at a time. So a manufacturing equipment, let's start with that.
Yes.
Unanimously.
Yes, purchasing controls are required.
And we'll talk a little bit about that in the next presentation with process validation and the concept of qualifying your equipment and doing equipment qualifications, because if, at least in my experience, capital equipment is not cheap. So capital equipment that you're purchasing for your manufacturing process is something that you're going to spend some resources on. And therefore, you're going to want to qualify those suppliers to ensure that you're getting the right equipment in order to meet your manufacturing process capabilities. And you're probably going to build in there some sense of how you're going to handle maintenance, repairs, and other things that are going to continue on.
Okay, so then the second part of this is off-the-shelf software.
Yes. Product or services that you receive for your manufacturing of your finished device, you would have to have purchasing controls in place.
Okay.
Now, the important thing to note about that is when we're talking about off-the-shelf software, that's typically going to be a larger supplier who's providing something that's not necessarily just for medical device use. If you're in that kind of situation, there are certain things you certainly won't be capable of doing, like having a supplier agreement may not be a reasonable expectation.
Or
a
supplier audit.
Or a supplier audit as well. So it is important that you exert supplier controls while understanding what you're really capable of. And the expectation isn't that you're going to do things that are really impossible.
But okay. Just keep in mind that although there may be some information or some activities that you're unable to conduct or have, for example, a purchasing agreement with that manufacturer, that still does not relieve you of your regulatory requirements as the finished device manufacturer.
Yeah. Okay, thank you. We've got a lot of questions, so this is fantastic. We'll just try to get through as many in the next 10 minutes as we can. Our next question, we are a contract manufacturer and we receive components from our customer to use in their product assembly. Are we required to exercise purchasing controls for this customer supplied material?
I think that question was asked earlier on.
So it is similar to that, okay.
Right. And the question goes back to, it will depending upon the relationships that set up, but it should be covered by some person at some point, either by you or by the original device manufacturer in their contractual agreement.
Okay. Let's get to our next question. When are purchasing controls reviewed during an inspection?
Easy one. So purchasing controls typically are reviewed when the investigator is conducting his review or inspection of your production and process control subsystem, and that usually takes place during a routine level 2 QCID inspection. It often takes place during a pre-market approval application inspection or pre-approval inspection as well. And then, of course, it could take place in the event that there is a for cause, when we have an issue or concern that we are addressing and we are specifically conducting an inspection with regards to some concern. It may be an indication that we need to look at purchasing controls because there's some concern that there is an issue with the product or services that you are receiving with regards to that finished device.
Okay.
And the one thing that I would piggyback on that to mention is there may be occasions where your supplier is considered a finished device manufacturer and we have gone out and inspected them and we've identified some issues there. There is the potential that you'll sometimes get an inspection where we are specifically going in there to look at your supplier controls because we want to see how you've handled the fact that those problems exist at your supplier.
All right, thank you. So for next question, if the received component is a 510K cleared device, does this product require any additional purchasing controls?
It's a received component and it's cleared under 510K,
right,
it would still require purchasing controls if you're doing something further to process it outside of just being a distributor. So if you're underneath of the, I guess a better way to put it is, if you're underneath of a quality management system and you're doing something further to that purchased 510K, whether you're relabeling, repackaging, or doing some other manufacturing activity, then the purchasing controls would still apply.
So let me elevate this question. It implies that this device, which was 510K cleared, is now being used as a component. Let's interpret that to be as part of a larger system.
Yes.
So if nothing else is being done and it's being used consistent with its intended use, are there any further purchasing controls required for that component?
Yes. And the example that I like to use for that type of situation is with HIP systems, for instance, where each of the individual components of it is a finished device in and of itself. Each of them might have a 510K, but when you put them all together, they create a system that does something very different than the sum of its parts. You have different bearing surfaces that go against each other, and it really comes down to that intended use. It really comes down to, are you evaluating that supplier according to what you need their product for? And so there really are some supplier controls that are necessary in order to evaluate them to see whether they're meeting the requirements of your system, It's not enough.
And of your system, not of just that component system.
Correct.
Exactly. Yes.
Okay.
Yes. It's looked at the finished device.
As a combination.
Yes. Yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Excellent. Okay. Our next question. Are contractors and consultants considered the same? And there's more, but I'll start with that question.
Okay. Contractors and consultants. Consultants and contractors both would make up being suppliers if they are providing you with a service. A consultation is a service that they're providing you. Contractors also would be providing you perhaps a service as well as product. So I would hate to say potato, potato, but it depends on what activities, what name you give them. So both
okay.
of them do have to have, you do have to have purchasing controls in place to receive those services from a consultant and to receive those product and or services from a contract manufacturer.
So the second part to this question, which mm-hmm. I think you answered, asks, mm-hmm. do they both need to undergo supplier controls?
Yes.
The answer is yes.
Yes.
The third part is, there's a third part. What if they work in-house? So that I'll mm-hmm. interpret this to mean, what if these are staff or orgs that are within your organization, but they provide this distinct service as consulting or contracting. Is there any difference in
yes.
the overall answer
there
to that?
There is a difference.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Because when in a contracting role, they aren't necessarily under your quality system the way that a direct employee would be. They're not necessarily in your training system. They're not necessarily under your management control system. So there are definitely supplier controls that need to be exerted there because this isn't a direct employee.
Correct. And I would go further to say, are they part of your organizational
yes.
chart? Where do they fit? What type of authority and responsibility do they have as part of your organizational mm-hmm. chart? And where are they covered? Because generally what I've seen is they're outside of that, therefore they have to be qualified through purchasing controls.
Right. Mm-hmm. So it may not be that they would meet the requirement to have purchasing controls. They may have some incoming acceptance activities, as Joe indicated, whether or not they are a part already of your quality management system or your internal audit system. So you have controls over them with regards to that aspect.
Correct.
So.
And I would say with consultants, I would make sure to qualify them for the particular work that you're contracting them to do. For example, if I was having somebody as a consultant work on a 510K, I would want to make sure that they have proper work having done pre-market mm-hmm. submissions versus if I were looking for somebody to do quality systems work, I would want to make sure that they have that quality system background to do that work.
So we have a follow-up question based on our discussion just now, and I'll ask this question. You just explained about incorporating risk into purchasing control. Can you please provide any example or examples about how exactly risk can be incorporated into purchasing controls?
Sure. One example of how you can incorporate risk into purchasing controls is through that aspect of evaluating risk and doing a tiered system. So you could say that a given supplier provides a critical product that is high risk, and based on that, you might have a higher audit frequency if you do supplier audits, or you might determine that that means that you have certain limits that really need to be met, and you do additional acceptance activities which really fuel your supplier controls as well by giving you that added confidence on the other side. And it's really about how you evaluate those suppliers, how you exert those evaluations such that you're still exerting supplier controls over all of your suppliers, but the level of supplier controls, the extent of the controls that you're exerting on them might change based on the risk of what they're supplying.
Correct. For example, you mentioned the supplier audits. I know very few firms that do supplier audits of all their suppliers. Usually
right.
supplier audits they take time, they take resources. Therefore, what I have seen is that's generally the higher risk category because you're going to spend some time actually going out to that supplier and looking at their firm, seeing if they have a quality system in place or whatever other requirements and specs that you put on as part of that evaluation.
Right.
So, and even, I'm sorry, go ahead, Tanya.
Sure. And even to go a little further or to begin at an initial step with regards to incorporating risk management activities with regards to your suppliers is even in evaluating the suppliers. You may have a far stricter or more detailed evaluation of those suppliers that will be providing you with those critical components or products or services versus a supplier that's providing you a less critical product or service.
Excellent. So that will be the last word on this session and the last question we answered. You did an incredible job in sending us these questions. We appreciate that. Thank you for your participation and your thoughtful questions. This concludes our segment on purchasing controls, and we hope you found this program informative. We have a survey that you'll find on our website. We'd like to hear from you as this helps us to plan future programs that meet your regulatory needs. That link is being shown on the screen now. Let's now transition to our second topic of the day, process validation. Once again, you'll hear from Joseph Tartle, who will present the topic. At the conclusion of his presentation, we'll bring back the expert panel for an interactive question and answer session with you. See you in a little while.
Hello, my name is Joseph Tartle, and I'm the Post-Market and Consumer Branch Chief in the Division of Industry and Consumer Education. There is a lot of great educational material available on quality systems, including how to design the right device so it'll meet your user needs, and how to qualify your suppliers so the products and services received meet your needs to manufacture that device. These efforts require your valuable resources, such as time and money. The last thing you want now is to have problems during manufacturing, such as device failures. This is where process validation comes into play. During my years in industry, I spent time performing process validation work, and it felt good to know that when done correctly, the manufactured devices were going to meet their predetermined specifications every time. At the end of the day, this is what you want, your customers want, and we at FDA want: working devices that meet specifications. I want you to know the following learning objectives. Understand the background and definitions in regard to process validation, such as where did process validation come from in the 1996 regulation, and what are the key terms used. Understanding these definitions is important so that everyone is using the same terms and those terms are used correctly. Recognize when process validation is required and when it may be a good idea, even if not required. Understand the process validation regulatory requirements. These are the shalls and musts per the regulation. You have to do these. Identify guidance and best practice information such as installation, operational, and performance qualifications. Understand requirements for process monitoring, process changes, and when to revalidate. Once completed, process validation does not go into a file, never to be reviewed again. One thing I can guarantee is this: at some point, change will occur. So how do you plan to handle that change? The requirements for process validation can be found in 21 CFR 820, otherwise known as the Quality System Regulation, which was published in the Federal Register in October 1996. Also, there was a lot of good discussion between the FDA and all stakeholders when the draft rule went out for public comment. These comments and the agency's responses can be found in the preamble of the regulation and are useful to review in order to understand the FDA's thinking at that time. First, I want to provide some background history on process validation. Process validation is codified in the regulation under 21 CFR 820.75. It was not new to the 1996 Quality System Regulation. Parts of it came from the original 1978 Medical Device Good Manufacturing Practice Regulation, or GMP. Lots of work was done regarding process validation during the 1970s, 80s, and 90s. After this presentation, please feel free to click on the hyperlink. Process validation, like many other quality practices, has consistently evolved. The Global Harmonization Task Force, or GHTF, 2004 guidance is the most current resource that addresses medical device process validation. As a reminder, guidances are voluntary and not mandatory. However, guidances often provide good suggestions, ideas, and recommendations on how to meet agency requirements. The GHCF guidance may be found at the International Medical Device Regulators Forum webpage in the GHDF archives under Study Group 3. Here's a link to the Study Group 3 webpage. Next, I want to mention that the quality system works together and is intertwined. It is not in separate silos. Design and design transfer will feed into production and process controls, as well as process validation. Let's consider the example of risk analysis. You'll want to know the impact of risk on the manufacturing processes and specifications, especially for essential design outputs. Risk analysis can help you to determine priorities and focus resources, even with processes and process validation. ISO 14971, a voluntary risk management standard, can help, and I have seen it used in industry for analyzing process risk. Also, what is purchased, products and equipment, and their specifications will affect your processes. For example, if there is a component and it is deemed an essential design output, you may request your supplier to perform process validation as part of your purchasing controls agreement. Who you hire and how they are qualified or trained will impact your processes and process validation. And of course, production and process controls in general will impact process validation. For example, the regulation requires under 21 CFR 820.70i that automated processes be validated. Now let's review several definitions as they relate to process validation, as I want to be clear on these terms. This is important when conversing in your own internal cross-functional teams or when speaking with an investigator. Verification means confirmation by examination and provisions of objective evidence that specified requirements have been fulfilled. By objective evidence, I mean supporting the existence or truthfulness of it. Objective evidence may be an observation, a measurement, or a test. For example, I can measure an item on its scale to verify how much it weighs. Next, let's define validation. Validation means confirmation by examination and provision of objective evidence that the particular requirements for a specific intended use can be consistently fulfilled. Again, objective evidence that confirms requirements for first, specific intended use, design validation, and second, can be consistently fulfilled, process validation. For design validation, an example may be a clinical trial and the results. And for process validation, an example may be a process validation protocol and its results. Last, we'll look at process validation. It means establishing, define, document, implement, or do it by objective evidence that a process consistently produces a result or product that meets its predetermined specifications. It is reproducible and predictable and gives me a known predetermined output. This is the end goal for process validation, as we know that manufacturers should not rely solely on inspection and testing to ensure that product is adequate. Now that we know what process validation means, when do we have to do it? Process validation is required when a process cannot be fully verified by subsequent inspection and tests. Fully verified means being able to confirm with high confidence all of the key quality attributes. For example, if I am performing an injection molding process, I need to look at all the molded pieces as well as all of their key quality attributes. These may be dimensional measurements, which may be fully verifiable, and also strength specifications, which may require impact resistant testing, which I cannot fully verify since it is destructive. Therefore, the process must be validated. Also, all injection molding processes that I am aware of are automated. This is another reason to validate. And injection molding is specifically noted in the preamble as a process that requires validation. However, you need to make these determinations for your own processes. To further expand upon this, here are three other process examples and the thoughts behind why I believe they would or would not require validation. Please note these are examples and not absolutes, so you will need to characterize your own specific processes and their results. Is validation required for a sterile package sealing process? The answer is yes. Sterility requires process validation, and the packaging process requires destructive burst testing. What about the dimensions of a manual cutting process? In this case, likely not. If I can measure all the dimensions and key quality attributes from every output, then I can fully verify the process. Also, the key word is manual. We validate processes, whereas we qualify people. So if a person is manually performing the whole process, then the person is qualified through training. And finally, let's consider the example of a filling process. This depends. Is the filling process automated or manual? Is it aseptic? The preamble and the GHTF guidance provide some good examples as to when certain processes should be validated. Also, even if not required to validate, I may want to do so for other reasons, such as cost. I recommend reviewing the GHTF guidance decision tree, Figure 1. It's a good tool to use. For example, you may have a process that can be fully verified, but the test is cost prohibitive. This is not an FDA concern, but it is your concern, and therefore, you may want to validate. According to 21 CFR 820.75, if the process cannot be fully verified, then you must validate. A natural question is, when should you start your process validation? The answer is, the earlier, the better. There are no requirements in design controls, but there are requirements under finished device acceptance activities that all activities must be completed prior to release. This includes the device master record requirements, such as process validation. Therefore, no finished device can be released into distribution until process validation activities are completed. As for when to begin, I suggest beginning process validation during design transfer so that you'll have actual manufacturing units for design validation. That's one reason why it's good to have cross-functional teams. Otherwise, you'll need to prove why the prototypes are equivalent to actual manufacturing units. Pragmatically, you can also start to address any issues that may arise from manufacturing scale-up, production facilities, capital equipment, identified process risk, and potential changes. Master validation plans are not required in the quality system regulation. However, I highly recommend using a master validation plan as it helps you to develop a roadmap for what needs to be done, how it will be done, and who will do it. It's recommended in the GHTF guidance, and it's considered a quality plan. Also, it becomes extremely important when you have multiple process and multiple process validations going on at the same time. For example, I once set up a manufacturing process in a clean room that needed to look at contamination controls, HVAC and airflow, water systems, gowning, and multiple manufacturing processes. The only way I could keep track of everything was by using a master validation plan. The requirement in the regulation is that you must have those approving the validation date and sign it, and include, where appropriate, the major equipment used. Where appropriate means it is appropriate unless you document a justified rationale for why it is not. For example, if I have a heat sealing process and I have multiple heat sealers, it's appropriate to identify each one of them specifically. Those personnel performing validation work must be qualified to do so. This means they must be trained and qualified in the process, use of the equipment, and process validation. Personnel who perform verification and validation activities also need to know about defects that may be encountered. I'll use the heat sealer example again. Personnel performing the validation must be trained in the heat sealing process, including the use of the heat sealer, and they must be aware of the defects that may occur, such as not having a proper seal or any other defect. Please note that we validate processes and qualify all equipment used in the manufacturing processes. 21 CFR 820.70G states that you must ensure that all equipment used meets its specified requirements and is designed, constructed, placed, and installed correctly for its use. The GHTF guidance discusses this further and simply states that everything must be installed correctly. It provides items to consider, such as equipment, design features, insulation, and environmental conditions, including ancillary systems such as electrical requirements. For example, with a heat sealer, is there a 110-volt or 220-volt electrical outlet requirement? Is there enough space in the room if it requires cooling? Also, safety features and supplier documents, such as equipment manuals and more, are noted for consideration. In the end, for installation qualification, be sure that your equipment is installed correctly and is capable of doing what you need it to do. Now I want to discuss operational qualification, or OQ. Here you want to challenge your process and its parameters in order to understand and characterize it. You want to know its capabilities, its capacity, and its ranges. You want to determine your process control limits, material specifications, process change control, and training needs. It is an experimental phase, and you can see worst-case scenarios, including running to device failure. Just make sure the resulting product is quarantined. You want to see how far you can push your processes. If you previously conducted a process risk analysis, such as a failure mode event analysis, then test that analysis. See if the results match the initial analysis, then update your risk analysis accordingly. Perform verification and validation for any software used in the process. Operational qualification is a time to understand your manufacturing processes, including how process inputs impact process outputs, and how they relate to specified criteria and limits. The time you invest upfront to understand these parameters and their impacts will pay off later on. For example, in the heat sealing process, what interactions among different parameter settings affect the seal's output? If I change the temperature, pressure, and time, what does it do to the seal's thickness and strength? If these are set too high, they may damage the materials and equipment. If they are set too low, there's not a proper seal. What happens when these are changed? How does it affect process outputs? I want to know this in order to set the most appropriate process parameter settings. Once you verify output that meets product specification when manufactured within established operating limits set in your operational qualification, you will move on to performance qualification, or PQ. In PQ, we do not expect failure. It builds off the work done in OQ and continues to look at measurable attributes for continuous monitoring. Use the approved documented procedures that will be used by all the trained and qualified manufacturing staff. Perform it under anticipated normal manufacturing operation. It's a good idea to cover multiple operators, lines, and shifts if you have more than one. I've noticed for overnight shifts that it's always interesting to see what happens differently compared to the day shift. You do not want differences in performance. Instead, you want things to operate the same on all shifts, night or day, and regardless of operator. Also, you should consider possible factors that result in longer-term variation, such as seasonal changes in humidity, which is an issue in certain regions like the southern United States. The goal is to ensure the process is repeatable and stable long-term. How many runs and samples are needed, and at what frequency? You determine it. What I can say is 3 is no longer the magic number. I understand it once was, and was even debated in the regulation. I remember using 3 back in the mid-1990s, but today you should determine the number of runs using a rationale such as a statistical significance. You determine it and support your rationale. For example, if you use a percent confidence, then you must understand what that means for the process and why that statistical tool was utilized. Run length, sample size, frequency, and duration need to be defined and understood when used. The GHTF guidance says it should be repeated enough to assure that the results are meaningful and consistent. If things go well and you have a controlled process, you will build upon each aspect of the validation and zero in as it moves forward. The IQ will provide your equipment capabilities, the OQ your operational limits as identified from the challenge conditions, and then PQ in the center with your nominal operating settings. This is what you want, and this leads to a stable and capable process. Stable means you get the same results over and over. Capable means those reproducible results fit within its remaining variation into your specifications. This is what gives you confidence that the process with known inputs will give you predictable and predetermined outputs. These may be materials, components, or finished devices. Unfortunately, not all processes work out this easily. Sometimes you may have to redesign the process, and other times you may even have a known rate of failure. When this is the case, be able to control and explain it. Also, know how your monitoring, inspecting, and testing relate back to your device risk and the risk-benefit determinations identified. Does this mean we are now done to never look at the process again? No. You still have to monitor it over time. Now, if you've done OQ correctly, then you already know the important measurements to monitor. And if you've done PQ correctly, you know their frequency with regards to everyday operations. The regulation states you must establish procedures for monitoring and control to ensure that specified requirements continue to be met. The proper monitoring is important as it will identify and detect changes over time. The process validation monitoring will take into consideration how robust the process is. If the process is influenced by some variation, thereby making it not fully capable, then it will likely require more monitoring. You may also want to use statistical process controls to look at deviation and percent confidence. Also, control charts and action limits can be established and used. For example, action limits for seal temperature can be set prior to device specification failure. As the results are monitored, adjust the temperature and monitor the process before specification failure occurs. As time goes on and your process is stable, always meeting your target, you may decrease the frequency of monitoring, but you determine that. Production and process changes. One thing I can tell you, it is not a matter of if, but when you will have process changes. When you make changes to specifications, methods, or process, equipment, and materials, you have to see if those changes now require verification or validation where appropriate. The verification or validation must be done prior to implementation of the change. This may prompt a new validation or, if previously validated, require revalidation. Revalidation. When changes to a process or deviation occur, the manufacturer must review and evaluate the process and perform revalidation where appropriate. Changes to processes, as we just discussed, or process deviations, such as an increase towards action limits or failures, for example, a decrease in seal strength or open seals from the heat sealing, then process must be evaluated and revalidated unless there is documented justification as to why it is not needed. Here is a list of additional examples of revalidation. Changes to the actual process, such as a new heat sealer or piece of equipment. Negative trends, for example, monitoring shows that the sealer is running hot and trending higher. Product design changes, like a new pouch, packaging material that could have an effect on the sealing process, and finished device. Even moving the equipment from one part of the facility to another may require revalidation. Also, for revalidation, maybe just part or the entire original validation needs to be completed again. That is for you to determine. Just make sure to document and justify why. Historical data, information and data from the device history records, such as batch records, control charts, and inspection can be used. I'll let you know that quantitative data is generally more useful than qualitative. Also, the historical data does not usually give you a complete picture. So while useful, by itself, it will likely not be enough. However, historical data can be used for any validation. Thank you for your time, and in summary, I ask that you take on the following call to actions. Understand your legal obligations for process validation. Use the GHTF guidance as a voluntary tool to meet those obligations. Perform process validation to ensure that predictable and predetermined outputs are always the case and specifications are always met. This presentation and other helpful videos and educational resources can be found at CDRH Learn. For text-based information on pre-market and post-market topics, including how to bring a medical device to market, please visit Device Advice. For additional information on these or any other medical device regulatory topics, feel free to call us at the Division of Industry and Consumer Education by phone or email our contact information listed on this slide. Thanks for watching.
Thank you for viewing the presentation on process validation. I hope you found it informative. We're joined now by your presenter, Joseph Tartle, as well as the rest of our expert panel, Eric Horowitz, Quality Systems Working Group Lead from CDRH's Office of Compliance, and Tanya Wilbon, Quality Systems Specialist in CDRH's Office of In Vitro Diagnostics and Radiological Health. Thank you, panelists. Please remember, you can submit questions by asking the Ask a Question icon, which looks like a thought bubble on the top left corner of your screen. You can also call us at 1-800-527-1401 to ask your question live. We're available to take your questions until 3 p.m. This is your time to interact with our medical device experts, so we'd love to hear from you. While we're waiting for your calls, we'll get started with some email questions you've already submitted. So let's get to our first one. What is the difference between design validation and process validation? So, Tanya. Okay.
Yes, I'll take that one. Design validation specifically means confirmation by objective evidence that your device specifications meet the intended use or your user needs. Whereas process validation is that confirmation by objective evidence that your process can produce your product repeatedly over and over again with that high level of assurance that it is meeting those requirements.
Okay, thank you. Mm-hmm. Our next question. Some have asserted that FDA's 2011 document called Guidance for Industry Process Validation, General Principles and Practices is to be applied to medical devices. However, the 2011 document states that it's only applicable to drugs and biologics, and that devices are excluded. Please help to clarify whether this document should or should not be applied for device process validation. So, Eric, can you field that question for us?
Sure. Generally speaking, no. That guidance document should not be used for medical devices. It's not intended for medical devices. It's very specifically for biologics and drugs. Now, if you're making a combination product that adds a different element to things because there's the aspect of whether you meet those requirements for the drug constituent part, and there's different aspects about what is required if you're making a submission, for instance, those sorts of considerations are there for combination products. But if you're not making a combination product, generally speaking, for medical devices, the answer is no, you should not be using that guidance document.
Okay, excellent.
Correct, and I'd like to add one other thing that comes up every once in a while in DICE, which is that 2011 guidance that's been rewritten for drugs and biologics comes originally from a 1987 guidance that every once in a while we'll get questions within our division saying, I have this 1987 guidance going back forever. Do not use that guidance either. It has since been withdrawn and been taken off the website. And I know some people will still find it. I'm recommending do not use it.
All right, thank you, panelists. So actually, we have our first caller who's called in. Caller, Achilles, can you ask your question for us?
I can. The question is, what is the perspective and guidance on retrospective validation using planned process deviation?
So, Tanya, would you like to field that?
Sure. You can use retrospective validation information with regards to your finished device. However, the expectation is that you do collect that prospective data and then utilize that in the future to demonstrate that your process or your validation is still providing you with that high level of assurance that your specifications are being met. So you certainly can use retrospective data, but you do have to collect that prospective data.
The other thing that I would add to that is anytime you're using retrospective data, you need to be very clear about how you're collecting that data. It needs to be very well documented that that data is being collected in a planned manner such that it's clear that you're not cherry picking data points that just meet what you want them to say. There's that added level of complexity, that added level of care that really needs to go into retrospective process validation to make sure that not only is the validation done well, but you actually have some data integrity as well.
Excellent, thank you. Thank you, panelists. Let's get to our next question for Joe. If I believe there is no risk to the patient or user, would FDA accept not validating a process, even if the process is not fully verified by subsequent inspection?
Okay, so the first part of that question, there's an expectation that there's no risk. And for all medical devices I know of, there is some risk. There's always going to be some risk. It may be in a reasonable amount of risk, but there's going to be risk involved. And using that aspect of the risk as an excuse to not do process validation, I do not think is going to fly, that you're still going to have to do some level of process validation, because the reg is pretty clear on if you cannot fully verify, then you have to do process validation. The level of process validation will then be dependent upon what you need and what confidence level you need for that process. But I wouldn't use the argument back to the risk of the patient as to a reason for not doing process validation work.
Okay, thank you. Let's get to our next question. FDA has stated that the design control process includes design of the device and the manufacturing process for that device. Therefore, is process validation part of design validation or design transfer?
So the best place that you could really put it is design transfer. It really is an aspect of design transfer in that it's showing how you are able to meet the requirements of the device design through manufacturing, which is the real purpose of design transfer, is to show if we go about manufacturing in the way that we have laid out in our DMR, we're going to produce a product that meets our design requirements. Design validation is far more about the aspect of the design specifications themselves of the finished product. And the way that I like to make a kind of explanation of the difference is that design validation is all about talking about what your product can do. Process validation is all about talking about what your product will do.
Excellent.
And I would add one thing further, that during the design stages, whether you're talking about design inputs and outputs, your design validation or design transfer, it's always good to have those discussions with your cross-functional teams. I've seen instances where you may be talking about design validation of that product and what it can do, and then when you start talking about larger scale production of that, manufacturing starts having their head spin and go, okay, yes, that was fine for that smaller scale, but now you're taking it up to a much larger scale. So it is always good to have those cross-functional discussions earlier rather than later, because you don't want to waste your time and resources going down a certain path only to have that change.
Thank you. All right, so we'll get to our next question. Do I need to justify sample size when establishing process limits during OQ? Tanya.
Certainly. Within the quality system regulation, 820.250 requires that when you are conducting sampling, then you must sample based on a statistically valid methodology. So your sampling plan must be statistically based. You cannot just randomly select or decide the number of samples that you're going to use to validate your process or verify, even if you're using sampling in your verification activities.
Excellent.
And that level can change, as we discussed earlier, based on risk. If you have a very risky process, you may need a high level of confidence in your output, and so you have to have a higher sample. Whereas if you have a lower risk process, it's possible that you might not need quite as many samples to have the confidence that you need for that given OQ.
Which all should still be statistically based. So yes. Make sure that your statistical methodology supports what you are trying to validate and or verify.
And understand that statistical method. Because as someone at the center and has done auditing, I can understand a lot of basic statistics. And if I go in and I'm looking at a firm or talking with a firm and I say, what does this methodology mean with regards to how you're using it? And you can't answer that question. I've now lost confidence that, yes, you're using a statistical method, but you don't really understand it.
Thank you. So we have our next caller who's called in. Our caller is named Eric. Eric, thanks for joining us. And what is your question for the panel?
Hi, we work with a contract manufacturer that manufactures machined implants. So we were wondering what level of process validation would be expected with these machine parts.
The level of validation, of course, depends on what you have determined within your facility that gives you that high level of assurance that your process will produce the product that meets your specified requirements over and over again. So that is dependent upon you as the manufacturer. And you have to identify those specifications and determine and dictate how you're going to demonstrate that they have been met.
Correct. If I heard right, it was a contract manufacturer. The quality system regulations still apply to contract manufacturers for all the applicable work that they're doing. So if they're a contract manufacturer, they're responsible for also doing process validation work. And you're responsible as the OEM to ensure that they're doing that process validation.
Eric, thank you for your question for the panel. So let's go on to with our next online question. Is IQ, OQ, and PQ validation required on a finished device, even when the device has undergone input-output matrix testing, risk assessment, and quality control verification testing?
So there are a lot of questions built into one right
there. So maybe break that down into
right there. I'll try to address at least a couple of them. The first was, is IQ, OQ, PQ a requirement? And the answer is no. The process validation should be done with a method that makes sense for your process, that makes sense for your product. It doesn't have to be in the form of IQ, OQ, PQ, so long as you are qualifying your equipment and you're performing process validation in a statistically valid method. The second part of that, from what I was gathering, was with regard to whether you have to validate the finished product. And that gets into a different type of validation, which is a whole product validation. Generally speaking, that type of validation is not what you should be relying on. It relies on you looking at the whole picture of your of all of the processes you do and coming to a conclusion without a whole lot of control over the individual processes involved. I would encourage you to do process validation of the individual processes which require it. And yes, there is some added benefit to doing final product validation. It just shouldn't be what you're relying on.
Okay.
I'll let you guys field if there were other parts of the question.
No, I think you hit it on with regards to control of your processes building up. If you're waiting until the very end, you're kind of getting in late in the game. You want to have more controls up front in those individual processes as they're going on.
So we have a follow-up. Thank you, panelists. We have maybe a follow-up question that addresses a different aspect of performance qualification. So this question asks, if I only manufacture limited quantities that are not sufficient to get statistical data, how can I do my PQ or performance qualification?
So of course, there may be situations when you're not producing a sufficient amount where a actual number perhaps is not statistically valid. In that scenario, let's say, for instance, you are producing one large instrument mm-hmm. that you're going to use and you're only making one a year. We know you can't run these validation activities on multiple instruments over multiple days because you just don't mm-hmm. produce that. That's all taken into consideration with regards to what methodology you employ when you decide on what you need to sample and how your sampling will take place. So we understand that that situation exists, and there are ways you would employ your statistician to assist you with that, as well as perhaps a clinical reviewer with regards to what types of studies you may need to put in place.
And the other thing that I would say is when you do have low volume like that, the important thing is to keep in mind the aspects that you are not going to have confidence in because you have that low volume and you're not able to really do a robust validation of your process. It should be reflected in how you look at the other parts of your quality system. Your acceptance activities, for instance, should reflect the fact that you aren't able to really gain that level of confidence that you would if you had a much higher number of products going through.
Thank you, Eric. Thank you, Tanya. So our next question, how does verification and validation pertain to manual processes?
Okay, so I can start with that. When you're talking about manual processes, you're usually talking about verification. One of the general rules of thumb that I've always heard is that you're going to verify things that people do, and you're going to qualify and train those people in order to do those manual mm-hmm. processes, because you can't validate a person. Right. So from the standpoint of verification, it's going to be a person who's doing it manually. They're going to do some sort of verification, and then you're going to get your confidence through their training and then qualifying them that training has taken hold, that they understand what they're doing.
Yes. And there is that aspect of what if I have a manual process that's not fully verifiable. And the important thing is that qualification, because it's not process validation, but that qualification of the process so that you have a certain level of confidence that our operators are capable with this process. And that actually involves some different methodology than it is with other types of processes. You have to take into account different times of day, different work shifts, the individual operators that you have so that you can gain that confidence in the process. And you actually may have to re-qualify things, really look at things mm-hmm. when you get a new operator, because you've made a change to the process by having someone new doing it.
And we even go one step further in the regulation and spell out that the people, personnel performing those type of verification activities have to also be aware of the defects that they might see. So it's not just that they know what a good device is, but they also know what a device where there might be particular problems that they can identify that, because you're not doing your process validation, you're handling it through that training and qualification.
Thank you all. We have our next call. Our caller is Kumar. Thank you for joining us. Can you share your question with our panel?
Sure. I have a question regarding using engineering design software. So typically when you're doing 3D modeling and using like CAD, CAM type of design, how do you apply process validation to something like that?
Okay, I'm not a software expert, so I'll preview this before I answer is, from my understanding, when I've talked to certain experts in the center, when you're dealing with any type of software, whether it's CAD or Excel, you have to do process validation for those specific functions in the software that you're using. So using CAD or Excel, if I have particular aspects of the program that I'm doing, I'm going to check and make sure through my process validation that it works out the way that it's supposed to. The other thing that I've heard with regards to that software is that now I'm not necessarily dealing with multiple samples, because if I do it the same way with that one time in the software, it's going to be repeated over and over and over, because that's the aspect of the way software works. So if you're using CAD to do particular 3D modeling, what particular parts of the program do you use, and how confident are you in that you're going to get the results that you should get when you test and characterize that software for the need that it is there being utilized for?
Right. So I can't stress enough that you are validating that software for its intended use. Mm-hmm. So whatever the purpose and the intended use of that software for the function that you are purchasing it for, that is what you are required by the regulation to validate it for. So
the other aspect that I would bring up about it is whether you have control over the software. If this is in-house developed software where you are able to develop all of the aspects of it, you'll be able to do white box testing on the software. You'll be able to gain confidence through testing the software itself. That requires a different methodology than if you have software that you don't have access to the inner workings of, that you're getting off the shelf, or you're getting from someone who isn't willing to provide you the actual code. That now you're going to have to do black box testing. There's going to be a whole different set of requirements about what you need to do in order to have confidence in that software.
Thank you, panelists. And Kumar, thank you for your question. We appreciate it.
So let's
get back to our next online question. This is yet another question about IQ. Is it acceptable practice to have a generic installation qualification, IQ, protocol for a specific type of tooling or equipment, and utilize this protocol to validate duplicate equipment? For example, each duplicate equipment would have its own specific report. Or should each specific equipment number have its own IQ protocol?
So long as it's clear what that protocol is used for, there's nothing wrong with having one protocol that can be used for multiple equipment.
Yep.
Where you might run into some issues is if you write up a protocol, it says the scope of this protocol is that it's about this specific piece of equipment, and then you use it for another piece of equipment. Now you're not really using it for what you said you were going to use it for. You might not have to really make any changes to it to use it on that other equipment, but you should at least be paying attention to what the purpose of that protocol was. But there is nothing wrong with creating one protocol that is used for all of the equipment of the same type, so long as you're sure that it's the same type of equipment and that it's being used for the same purpose.
Correct. And I would add to that, remember, when you're talking about an installation qualification is a term that's used in the guidance document, but according to the regulation, you have to qualify all equipment, regardless of if it's going to be used in process validation or not. Underneath of 820.70, all equipment that's used has got to be qualified for its intended use, maintenance, and other things. And what I would say is, you can use that same protocol, but be careful that if the models change, say I buy this piece of equipment today, this heat sealer today, and it's a certain model number, and I go and purchase another one 3 or 5 years later, and it's a newer model, then I got to take that into consideration with regards to qualifying that new piece of equipment to see, does my same qualification hold, or has there been changes to it? And I've seen that happen with new model numbers that come out over time.
And the other thing that I would add to that regarding installation qualification particularly is being cognizant of the environmental conditions.
Yep.
For where that equipment is being used. If they are different for a different piece of equipment, what's necessary for your installation qualification might not be the same. If you've put it into an environment where perhaps there's a different voltage socket or a different type of environmental controls. Maybe you're using one piece of equipment in something that has environmental controls, and you're using another one where the temperature might swing wildly because you're not controlling it. that's important things to know when you're doing your installation qualification.
And keep in mind, that's also a regulatory requirement also to have in place what you will do when you have changes to your process. So those would all be controlled under those procedures.
Excellent. So we have our next caller who's come in, Jay from Ohio. Thank you for joining us. And can you share your question with our panel?
Good afternoon, panel. My question today is, what is an adequate complaint analysis for process validation? And could you give us an example? The reason I'm asking this question is because when you review complaints, there's a lot of information in it. And how do we narrow down and say all these inconclusive complaints or conclusive complaints are due to the process and we have to revalidate the process? How do we link or make that link? And that's exactly my question.
Okay, so it sounds like you have a complaint that comes in, you're trending out your complaints and seeing certain issues during the complaint investigation that's linking back to a process. And I would say that as one of the indicators that if you start seeing negative trends, that you are to go back and revalidate particular processes. My linkage between the two that I've seen is your corrective action and preventive action system, and that you're going to use that system to link in your complaints into your processes and your process validation.
And an important part of how that can actually link to process validation is in the traceability of the product that you put out. The more that you know about what processes were done and when and with what parameters for the product that you've received the complaints about, the more that you can characterize exactly what went wrong, whether there might be a certain area of the process parameters that you're seeing more problems with, so that you can take that into account when you're revalidating or when you're thinking about whether the parameters need to be changed, and of course, revalidating.
Tanya, did you want to add something to this?
No, I just want to say that question does sound like it would require some additional discussions, and definitely welcome you to contact the center with regards to that. But here again, you know, it really depends on what information you find out as the entity that's actually conducting or trying to recreate that complaint. So it really depends on what you find out based on whether or not that process is not performing as intended or is not performing based on what's identified in those complaints. So that's a lengthy discussion, I would think.
Thank you, panelists. And thank you, Jay, for your question. We appreciate that.
So this, have a good day.
Thank you. You too. So this next question is actually for Joe and speaks to something you said earlier. What did you mean when you said historical data can be used for validations? In what sense can it be used?
Okay, so as part of the presentation, we talked about historical data, and I think a caller had used the term retrospective validation. So historical data is any information that you're driving from your device history records or process monitoring or any information that you can then use in your process validation itself. And the terms that I get here used all the time are retrospective validation, concurrent validation, prospective validation. And what I would say is try to get away from those terms, because what you're really talking about is using historical data, which is data that you had previously collected, and then trying to use that in order to build your validation. One of the things I will say with regards to that is it usually doesn't answer all of your questions. It usually definitely leaves out certain things with regards to characterizing your process that you would find in an OQ, an operational qualification. So while you can use that historical data to give you some baselines, it usually doesn't give you a complete picture. And what I would say too is, if I'm using historical data, quantitative data is going to be much more useful than qualitative pass-fail data, because the qualitative pass-fail data doesn't give me as much about really characterizing that process. So when I am digging into device history records to use historical data, I'm generally looking for qualitative data that can give me some sort of idea about the characterization of my process. And that pretty much is what I was talking about there.
Okay. So for our next question, what is an acceptable method to document when we determine that process validation is not required?
So here you would have to demonstrate that that process is fully verified, which means that you can demonstrate that all the attributes of that particular process can be met and will produce the product that you intend. So you have to demonstrate that that process can be fully verified in order to not be required to validate.
And that essentially
process.
That's the only way. That is okay. If you can fully verify, then you don't need to validate.
Yes.
Okay, next question. Can process validation include both catching expected failures as well as successfully patching units?
So,
can process?
I'm struggling with the question slightly. It sounds like it's about whether non-conforming product can be an aspect of process validation. If that's what the question is, it certainly, if looked at historically, it can be an input into process validation to drive how you validate the process in the future. You also can have statistics in your process validation that are with regard to if there is non-conforming product that's produced during your validation runs.
So it seems like the key here in this question is catching expected failure. So it implies you're anticipating where your threshold is. We expect failure to occur, and how can you build that into your process validation?
So I mean, not all processes are going to be robust and stable and capable. So when you're characterizing your process as part of an OQ, if you're performing an operational qualification, you may push your process to the limits that you might see failures. Or you may have a process that no matter how much you redesign that process, you know that there's always going to be a statistical number that you have to live with regards to that failure. And where you're going to transition that is, you're going to know that that particular, if you're not redesigning your device and you can't redesign your process, and you've gone through your risk analysis to say, okay, we're still within our risk categories of what we can do here, then you're going to build in as part of your process monitoring that aspect of from your process validation that we're always going to have that certain number of failure. I mean, that's the only thing I could think of with.
Right, and with that will, as Joe was alluding to with regards to process monitoring, that may be an indication, although you're meeting your level of acceptance with regards to what your process is capable of doing, you may then determine that you need tighter controls of that process once you determine that, oh, we're going outside of our allowable acceptance for this process to fail or not provide us with those conforming finished products. So that may be a trigger for you to implement tighter process controls in place.
And the other side of that is really, ideally, if you don't have a wildly variable process, ideally, you'd like to set up process monitoring so that you're able to catch when parameters go outside of set points so that you're able to catch it before non-conforming product happens. Mm-hmm. And you're able to make adjustments so that non-conforming product doesn't happen in the first place.
Correct. And that's a classical use you see of control charts, is that you're going to have a failure limit, and then within that failure limit, you're going to have action limits that you can take before you ever get to that point.
Yes. Right.
And that's ideal.
So I think we have time for maybe one or two more questions. We'll try to knock them out. For this next one, if we can 100% verify that the device meets its intended use through functional testing and visual inspection, does that alleviate the burden of specific processes used during the manufacturing?
You cannot inspect for quality, and that does not alleviate the requirement of having to validate certain processes or to validate all your processes or where appropriate, fully verify. So no, 100% inspection does not alleviate or exclude you from having to validate those processes.
Correct. And I was expecting to hear this question come up because
right?
We do receive it a bit with regards to this 100% aspect. And remember, as Tanya pointed out, you cannot inspect or test quality into the device. And even if you do 100%, it's been shown that you're still going to miss a certain level of defects. And you've already said that these processes, you need to have a high confidence level of all the quality attributes. So.
All right, panels, I think that'll be the last word for the session and for the program. So I wanted to thank you. And I'd like to thank all of you for participating and for your thoughtful questions today. This concludes today's CDRH Industry Basics Workshop. For any further questions you may have or ones that we didn't answer today, please send them to us at DICE. You can call us during our normal work hours or email us at DICE@fda.hhs.gov. We'd like to know your thoughts on today's program and look forward to your feedback. Please complete the survey at the link that appears on the screen now. The survey is also available on our website. We hope you found today's program valuable. Today's program, including the presentations and Q&A sessions, will be made available on the CDRH Learn website in about a week, so you can access them as a resource anytime you'd like. We look forward to hearing from you at DICE, and remember, we're always here to guide you through the CDRH regulatory process. We're just a phone call or email away. I'd like to thank our expert panel, our DICE colleagues who fielded the questions behind the scenes, the FDA studio team, and you, our audience, for joining us for today's program. Thanks again.